Okay, where can I see?
Canvas.
Okay.
It started working.
This one?
Yeah.
I just want to have a look how it's.
You're looking for.
Okay. Check it, thank you. Hello, assalamu alaikum and welcome to all of you in today's session. First of all, I would like to thank you for your interest coming in on Friday after the Friday prayer. That shows the level of interest in today's topic. Today's topic is sales tax returns for KPRA, which is Khyber Pakhtunkhwa Revenue Authority. We will be talking about some background regarding indirect taxes, the history of sales taxes in Pakistan, registration, filing, revising, and ancillary issues. Before that, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allah, open my heart and ease my task for me and remove the impediments from my speech so that they may understand what I say. Before going to my introduction, I would like to briefly talk about today's webinar and webinars in general. Most of you are normally ACCA members, so I believe you do appreciate the requirement of CPDs. Some of you are working at very senior positions and have a good knowledge and understanding of the CPD requirements of other bodies and how the CPD requirements for them operate. I mean, just now we were discussing, I wouldn't be naming anybody, that wouldn't be very professional, but there are other bodies who actually charge their members for every CPD event. As far as our own ACCA is concerned, ACCA has never charged its members anything from itself. On the other hand, ACCA provide all these CPDs free of cost. And some of these CPDs are very valuable. Some of them are planned in the pipeline. Some of them you would probably have already attended. And just continuing from what I was referring to, some of them are so valuable that in practice, when we are doing corporate sessions on those topics, each participant is paying to the tune of 50K to 100K for some of those topics. So all that value is being delivered free of cost for ACCA members. Now obviously it's up to us what we believe is more relevant for us and actually making use of these resources that are available. The interesting and useful thing is that even after the webinar is concluded, if somehow you've missed something or more importantly you need to refer back to something or understand something, ACCA provide you all these sessions free of cost available on major video sharing networks such as Vimeo. ACCA Pakistan's channel is free of cost there to subscribe and you get recordings of all these webinars on that. Similarly, on YouTube, there is ACCA Pakistan's channel, which again can be accessed for free of charge recordings of all these webinars. So guys, great values. Do try to watch the topics you think you need some assistance with, and let's continue with today's topic now. So first things first, some of you, especially those who have previously attended my sessions, would know me. For the newcomers, I'll quickly run through my intro. Omer Zaheer Meer, that's my name. I'm a fellow Chartered Certified Accountant, and I also hold an array of other professional qualifications and certifications such as CFA, AML, BSc Honor, Certified Mentor, Taxation, Specialization, etc. etc. Professionally, I'm currently working as a Managing Partner at Millennium Law and Corporate Company, which happens to be the pioneer ACCA practicing firm in Pakistan. On the training front, I'm an experienced trainer. And have been honored to have conducted mandatory promotional trainings of government officers at MPTD. I've worked with the likes of National Bank of Pakistan, HBL, Lahore Tax Bar, Karachi Tax Bar, Pakistan Tax Bar, Lahore Karachi Chamber of Commerce and Industries, our very own ACCA, UET, Barry, etc., etc. For those of you who do like to read, I'm a regular contributor on these technical subjects in major English language dailies as well as some major research journals, and being honored to be a receiver of ACCA's Exceptional Public Value Award. I'm currently serving for the fourth time as Chairman Liaison Committee of Lahore Taxbar. I'm also honored to be heading the Taxation Committee of ACCA Pakistan and being a member of MNP of ACCA Pakistan. I'm also on several think tanks and professionally associated with different professional organizations. So that's pretty much about me. You have this presentation available, and I believe Harun Jan, the regional head of member affairs, will be emailing you the copy of this and other material. They are actually uploaded in the handouts, so you can access them right now on your systems. You can quickly go through the remaining intro. Let's quickly try to jump into the table of contents. So this is basically what you can see on your screens is what we will be running through today. We will briefly begin with the background, what are taxation laws, direct versus indirect, the evolution of sales tax in Pakistan, where it is at present, what is KPRA, its intro, contact information, and basic legislation governing it. Just very quickly, we'll go through these basics. Then we have some handy stuff for you, which would come handy for those working in taxation, be it within an organization or practicing themselves. We'll then move on to registering for sales tax with KPRA, the e-enrollment under various circumstances. We'll also go through the filing of sales tax return, the filing of revised and nil return, and then we'll quickly discuss some ancillary issues, including the payment of due tax liability. Although the question answer session is listed separately at the end, we will actually be having question answers break in between. So if you get a question in between, just write it down. We'll have that appearing on the screen. We will have regular question answer break and I will answer them. I will try to answer each and every one of your questions, inshallah, but I would request you to try to focus your question on the topic in hand today. If we do get some spare time at the end of the session, I would be more than happy to answer any other question. But we have to be focused while we are going through the session and initially cover the main content for today. Just a professional acknowledgement that several legislations and other reports of KP Revenue Authority, FPR, are on my own practicing firm, MLCC, the pioneer ACCA practicing firm, have been utilized in the development of the presentation that we are going through. And obviously, we have a limited time, so we'll try to cover the major areas as extensively as possible within the time duration allotted to us. So first things first, taxation laws. What exactly is taxation? Not too difficult, is it? Basically, taxation laws are a set of laws which are devised to govern the population of any country in order to drive revenues for the government of that country so that the government can actually function and improve the lifestyle of its citizens. At least that is one of the primary aims. Well, Pakistan has actually one of the most complex taxation systems across the globe. Why I say that? Because not only there are several different types of taxes, giving rise to a lot of harmonization issues, the stages, the collection, the actual governance and structural issues just make it so much more challenging for an average taxpayer. So Pakistan's tax system has over 70 distinct taxes. Yes, that's right. This has led to several set of laws dealing with specific taxation areas. So taxes can basically be divided into two major categories. Every tax would fall within one or the other of these categories. First one, direct taxes, the other one, indirect taxes. Well, some of this stuff may sound a bit basic to the more experienced and senior ones of you, but bear with me, treat it as a quick revision because we do have some of the younger members as well, and we have to try to take everyone together. So, direct and indirect taxes. Direct taxes, they are levied on income directly. The the profit of a business, your salary, the income that is being earned. And indirect taxes are not levied on income directly, but rather on transactions and consumptions. For example, sales tax, excise duties, etc., etc. You buy a glass of you buy a glass of juice, a bottle of water, you are paying indirect taxes. So what exactly is sales tax? Well, first thing, sales tax is a type of indirect tax. It is an ad valorem tax. Ad valorem means the value of the tax is dependent on the value of the transaction. You are buying something worth 50,000. The tax rate on that is 15%. So the proportion will remain constant at 50%, but the higher the value of the transaction, the higher the value of the tax to be paid. As I've just told you, sales tax is levied on goods and services, and normally it's imposed on the gross price. What do we mean by the gross price? By gross price, we mean seller's net purchase price or the cost of the service plus the sales tax that the seller has paid to their supplier plus the seller's margin on top of that. So all of these are added together at each and every point of sale, and then the sales tax is levied on that. So sales tax is basically a cost to the end consumer, and because of the way it's been worked, because it's applied on the gross price, there is an element of double taxation involved. So this, this brings us to pretty much the last part of the background, the history of sales tax in Pakistan. For those of you who had attended the last session on PRA, they would be pretty well familiar or should be with this. However, I'll just quickly recap it for them, and for the rest of you, you'll learn something new today. So sales tax for Pakistan basically started pre-independence. Well, in 1935, the 7th Schedule to the Government of India Act under serial number 48 of List 2, the provincial legislative list, actually outlined the power to levy and collect taxes on the sale of goods and advertisement. So initially, the sales tax was basically on the sale of goods and just one service, the advertisement service, which was actually debatable whether that was a service or a product, because at that time, largely it was based on print media. Anyway, at that time, it was a provincial subject, not a federal subject. So this 1935 Act actually applied to Pakistan. Why? Because it was covered within the terms of Section 8 of the Indian Independence Act of 1947. However, a year after the independence in 1948, Pakistan worked on devising its own sales tax legislation, and we ended up with General Sales Tax Act 1948, which was enacted on the 1st of April 1948. The date was just a coincidence. Later, this said 1948 Act was superseded 3 years later by the Sales Tax Act 1951, which remained in operations till 1990, when the Sales Tax Act 1990 overrided that one. However, in between, in 1960, the Taxation of Goods, Sales and Purchases Order 1960 was introduced, and the scope of sales tax under the 51 Act was actually extended to include sale, importation, exportation, production, manufacture, and even consumption of the goods. So what was happening previously till 1951 was that the focus was very much on goods, but domestically produced and consumed goods. So in 1960, the scope was basically widened to include the import and export as well. So in 1990, the system further evolved, and the Sales Tax Act 1990 replaced the 1951 Act and introduced for the first time this VAT type sales tax on transactions, basically on goods, that we have currently existing in Pakistan. However, the sales tax on services was never within the federal legislature. It wasn't in the federal legislative list. It wasn't within the federal domain. It wasn't within the federal or the concurrent legislative list. Before you get confused, the federal legislative list included the matters which were exclusively within the Federation's domain. The Federation had to work on them, legislate on them, govern them. So concurrent list? The concurrent list basically outlined those areas which you can say in a way were joint areas. How? If the Federation didn't cover that area, the province can legislate for that and go on. However, if at any date the Federation was to come into play and legislate, then that would be devolved back to the Federation. Anyway, sales tax on services wasn't covered in either of them, so legally and technically, it was never within the federal domain. So the question that should arise in your mind was, but hang on, wasn't it that until the 18th Amendment, the sales tax were actually collected, governed, administered, and legislated for by the Federation? Yes, they were. But the reason for that was that the provinces, for once, there wasn't an absolute clarity. Secondly, there wasn't proper legislation done. Thirdly, there was no capacity with the provinces. The problem with that one was that there was no real motivation for the provinces to improve their taxation capabilities or ensure that maximum revenue can be collected from their provinces. I mean, the Federation was giving them a share of the total collection. They were happy. The share was basically based on the size of the population. So there was no real motivation for any province to excel. However, the things started to change with sales tax ordinance says of 2000, including the Sin Sales Tax Ordinance 2000, which were promulgated by the provinces and came into effect on 1st of July 2000, and the Central Excise Duty, which is now referred to as the FED, Federal Excise Duty, on such provincially taxed services were actually withdrawn in order to avoid the double taxation. However, the provincial tax on services continued to be administered and collected by the FPR under these ordinances to, again, capacity issues. However, later, in the terms of Article 8 and 9, subsection 2 of the 7th NFC award of 2010 and the, no surprise, 18th Amendment, the Sin Sales Tax on Services Act 2011 was the first proper set of legislation to be legislated by any provincial body. It was enacted by the Sin government and became effective from the 1st July 2011. And the Sin Sales Tax on Services was then administered and collected by SRP, Sin Revenue Board. It was followed by Punjab, which enacted its legislation in 2012. KPK was the third one to follow suit by introducing the sales tax rules in KPK in 2013. And the way KPK worked was slightly different. Instead of creating an entire separate act governing the sales tax on services, KP actually introduced these powers initially within the Finance Act 2013. And later on, every year, just like with the other bodies, the legislation is updated with the newly approved Finance Act. What is the Finance Act? Most of you would know well. The budget is introduced in the provincial assemblies, and that is referred to as the finance bill. Once that is approved and become a legislation, that is then referred to as the provincial finance bill. So in KB, we have the provincial finance act coming every year, and then we have the sales tax rules, which actually outline how the things are done in practice. Anyway, we are covering all this in ancillary issues and in between, and we'll be covering even a bit more the withholding regulation, so you would have a pretty good idea of the regulatory framework. Anyway, FPR issued a press release on 1st July 2011, actually withdrawing the federal excise duty on the services which were now taxed by the provinces. So, very good. Now we come within the actual core of this stuff. KPRA, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa Revenue Authority. Well, as you all are familiar, KPRA is the body, the provincial body, the revenue authority, which is responsible to collect and administer the sales tax on services within the domain of the province of Khyber-Pakhtunkhwa. It was established in 2013 and became effective from the 1st of July 2013, which was the tax year 2014. And all taxpayers who are providing services in Khyber-Pakhtunkhwa or are required to pay sales tax according to Khyber-Pakhtunkhwa Finance Act 2013. And these services were, by the way, earlier covered under the NWFP Sales Tax Ordinance 2000, which is common sense, was repealed by this development. So all those taxpayers were advised to transfer their registration from FPR to KPRA for e-enrollment and e-payment of KPRA sales tax on services. On your screens, you have the contact details of KPRA, their headquarter address, their support email, and their telephone contact detail. Well, I found that the email becomes very effective if you follow that up with relevant telephone calls. Normally, you might not need to actually visit them unless there is some complication or the matter is of some exceptional nature. Normally, you can get almost pretty much everything done using their email and telephone number. So, legislations, we were just discussing these, and I did share with you that it started with the Finance Act 2013. The Finance Act 2016 listed important changes. Then we have the recent one, Khyber-Pakhtunkhwa Sales Tax on Services Rules 2013, actually outlined the practical stuff, how the things are actually done in practice. You need to get registered. How would you get registered? Like the stuff that we'll see now comes out from there. Then you have the special procedure withholding regulations, which were issued in 2015, governing the rules and responsibilities of the withholding agent, how much tax you need to withhold when you are transacting with the counterparty, by when you need to deposit that, where would you disclose that in the return, whether that's adjustable or not, all that stuff. Tax calendar, those of you practicing should all, almost all of them should know that already. For the other ones, just have a look here. The last date of payment of withholding tax and sales tax on services is 15th of the month following the tax period. For example, if you are talking about the last month, October 2017, so the relevant date, last date, deadline for the payment of withholding tax and sales tax on services, 15th of November. Similarly, the last date to file the return, 18th of November. So basically, you have 15 months to make the pay, 15 days to make the payment after the end of the month, the relevant tax period, and you have 18 days to file your tax return. Which brings us to the registration for sales tax on services with KPRA for existing NKN holders. I'd like to show you the actual deal on the KPRA website. So let's open that up. kpra.kp.gov.pk. Okay, now this beautiful web page is the home page of the KPRA, Khyber-Pakhtunkhwa Revenue Authority. You do have the classification of the taxable services for KPRA here. All of you have access to this and can quickly go through that. They are pretty standard and pretty similar to the other provincial authorities. And I believe we did have a session on KP sales tax on services. So the recording will be available on ACCA's channels and you can quickly go through that. Should you need any assistance, you can always shoot me an email. So let's quickly talk about what we are set to do here. Well, obviously we'll visit the website, click on e-registration and the option for those having NTN. But this is all theory. Let's quickly see how we'll actually do that. So this is the e-registration button. on your screens. Now you have actually have these options there: new registration having NTN and check status of registration application. So you'll click on the first option, new registration having NTN. Then you'll enter the NTN number of your client, of yourself. Actually, if any of you do have an actual NTN that you'd like to share, so I can show you the entire complete process, that would be really great. But please make sure if you are sharing, it's your own detail and you are comfortable with a public demo of the information. Or if it's a client information, please make sure that your client has authorized you to use them. Yes, anyone? Anyone having an NTN number they'd like to share? Okay, apparently it seems like nobody has that. Okay, no problem. We'll just continue like that. So what you're gonna do is, you're gonna simply enter the NTN number here of any taxpayer that you have. I've just entered a made-up number here, and it's obviously gonna say no taxpayer found for this NTN. But if this was a valid NTN, your details from FPR would appear here. Depending on you are an individual AOP or company, obviously AOP and company won't have a CNIC, so you can actually double check whether the name appearing is the one that belongs to you. If not, you can contact FPR to rectify in the database. Then you'll enter these security image characters. Once you enter them, you'll click on OK, and it will basically take you to the FPR login page. And you'll need to enter your FPR login details. Once you'll enter login, it will give you a pop-up box asking you that, are you actually authorizing us to share your data with Khyber Pakhtunkhwa Revenue Authority? You will click on the affirmative, yes, valid option. And as a result, you would now be taken back to the KP website. So once you are taken back here, you would have to do a process of e-enrollment. What is that? We'll see that in a bit. Let's just first click here on the other option. So in e-registration, we went through this option, e-registration having NTN. We have two more options. In case you don't have NTN, and in case you just need to check the status of your application. Well, it's pretty straightforward. To check the status of your application, you'll enter the application reference number, which you were given as a result of the previous process that comes on your email, and your NTN number. Enter the image correct the characters, press on OK, it will give you the status. But the more interesting thing is the second option. New e-registration for those having no NTN. So let's click here. Nothing's happening. Basically, the link is dead. Okay, let's go on the home page. And here, the option doesn't even exist. So what's happening? I'll tell you what's happening, but let's just quickly have a look here. Here, with regards to registration of existing NTN holders, this is the information that KP Revenue Authority has put on its website. What it says is pretty standard as to what the other revenue authorities, provincial revenue authorities have shared. It says that please ensure you have the correct NTN and check digit. If you have that correct, then email us to this support email, which I've shared with you in the contact details, eSupport@kpra.gov.pk. and enter the, in the email subject AEE add, then your add NKM in database. Then in your email, write your NKM number, business name, and service category, and a support officer will have a look and reply you to email vendor. However, in practice, as you have seen, the link is dead at the moment. You can call the KP helpline and try to apply manually. In theory, they say that they will allot you a provisional registration certificate valid for 30 days, so you can go apply for an NTN, and if you don't get an NTN within 30 days, this would all be null and void. What happened actually is, it's outdated. This was a time when getting an NTN with FPR was cumbersome. It was a manual process, laborsome, took days with so many issues. Now, you can apply an NTN online. Even if you are a corporate entity, getting an NTN, if everything is all right and IRIS is working properly, is a one-day process. It doesn't take days, weeks, or in some cases, as it used to, months at a time. So what actually happens now, that instead of you having to apply using the option don't have an NTN, you simply go on the FPR website, click on IRIS, and actually apply for an NTN. So that is the reason that this link is dead, because it doesn't exist anymore. So in reality, you just have to apply for an NTN and use the first option, e-registration, using the option for NTN holder. So once you have completed the process and you have been taken to the FPR website, you have entered the image character, pressed OK, and you have allowed them to transfer your data to KPRA, then what happens? Looks like we have some feedback. Okay, some of you did share the taxation number, NTN number. Okay, that's good. And thank you very much for sharing that. I believe, Shahzad, you do have authorization from your client for this. Okay, Shahzad, either the NTN is not valid or it's one of those things that often happen with KP's website. If you do strike this issue that you have entered a valid NTN, and it's saying no taxpayer found for this NTN, you have to send an email to this support email and follow that up with a phone call. Normally it happens with individuals or the NTN who are not registered for sales tax with FPR. So if you are a corporate entity registered for sales tax with FPR, normally this problem doesn't happen anymore. Anyway, quickly going through the process. So once we have done the process as we discussed, we will log in on the KPRA Revenue Authority website, and it will take us to a standard form, pretty much the same like the FPR or PRAs as I've shown you in the last session. The first form, first section of the form is registry, where your particulars will already be appearing from what the FPR holds in its database from your NTN registration application. So you can have a quick look that everything is in an order, nothing is wrong. Then you will fill out the agent particulars under section 71, whether you are representing yourself, you are the principal officer, or you are acting on the behalf of a client. You'll save the registry. If it's a corporate entity, provide details of the directors and shareholders. Add any other activity if you have since started another business activity not already within the registry section. Add details of your business branches and bank account. And then you would simply sign the declaration. The last, you'll save the form, and that's it, done. You'll submit your application. In the form, in the end, you would see an area which would say official area, and it would show user ID allotted to you and the relevant tax office. However, that would appear automatically. There's nothing you can do about it. As a result of the process, KPRA will allot you a KP NTM. Well, in practice, it's your normal NTM, the one you are using with FPR, or at the most, they used to add the K initial in the start. The activation and passcode will be sent through SMS and email, respectively. Then you would have to complete the e-enrollment process. Now, what is this e-enrollment? And isn't it a bit confusing? What are we doing? We just registered. And why are we going for the e-enrollment? You registered in KPRA's database. Now you need to e-enroll to use their website to actually administer your taxation affair, to actually file your tax return, to actually pay your taxes. That's what we need to do now. So your e-registration process is completed. What would you do now? You'll come here and click on enrollment activation. You'll enter your NTM number. Let's just enter the one Shehzad gave us. You'll enter the activation code. This is a code that will be received on your cell phone. Then you'll enter the passcode, which will be received in your email. They would be received separately. Once you have entered these, then you'll click on the image character to prove that you are human and not a computer. You'll click on submit, and with the valid details, what will happen is the process will be completed and you would be sent an email as well as a copy on your mobile of your password and your PIN code. You have to keep that safe. Your login info would be your KNTN. So your login ID would be your KNTN. Your password will be sent on to you. And then you'll simply come here, enter your user ID, enter the password that you have set, and you'll log in into the actual taxpayer area. So that's where the process will be done and it's all gone. All done. You are now a registered taxpayer. However, you have to make sure that you have a valid email ID and mobile phone number, preferably the one you provided to FPR when registering for your NTM, so that you can receive your password and PIN from KPRA on them. So that was pretty much about e-enrollment activation. What about the new e-enrollment? Well, the new e-enrollment can be in case you were already registered for sales tax, etc., or you were under the previous system and you needed to do a new enrollment, then you would simply click on new enrollment. You will enter your tax number, taxpayer number, NTN. Let's enter the one Shehzad provided us, 545746. We'll click on this, and that's it. The process should be completed, and you will be redirected to FPR's login page. You will have to confirm that you want to transfer your particulars from FPR to KPRA. Then you'll be taken to the KPRA website and you will activate your enrollment and receive your new password and PIN just using the process of enrollment activation that we discussed just a moment ago. So just a correction, this will happen in the case of e-enrollment. In the case of your initial registration, once you have gone to see, this is what happened in the case of e-enrollment activation. Well, Shehzad's client is already registered, apparently, so we can just go and use his details to log in within the FPR. Shehzad, if you feel comfortable, would you be kind enough to share the login details for this NTM just for demonstrative purposes, which obviously you can change later on? It would just help us to show real time to everyone how does the real deal work, what happens out there actually. While Shehzad is responding, well, any of you who would like to share their own NTM detail and are comfortable with sharing the login info, please feel free to ask. We actually did ask a few of our KP clients, but they weren't very comfortable which a demo of their info, so unfortunately we can't use there. Shahzad has also apologized, so I think the clients are very sensitive with regard to this sharing their information. That's all right. We'll just make do with what we have. Okay, in the handout section, you do have these handouts of how to e-file the return, which we'll cover in a bit. You also have the section, this PDF presentation that we are going through at the moment. You have the PDF copy of the challan form. You also have the PDF copy of the payment system. How do you pay your taxes? We'll cover that in a bit. So within the new enrollment, you will just enter your login info. In TN you have, and then you'll enter the password you have, and that should take you to the FPR website where you'll authorize them to move your data to KP Revenue Authority. How is that different from e-registration? In e-registration, you are actually registering with the authority. In e-enrollment, you are using their website. So if you were to register, you will enter your detail, you'll press OK, it will take you to the FPR's form data, where it will be showing you all the data that FPR holds for you. And you just have to complete the registration application. Pretty straightforward. Add detail of your business, your bank account, any other activity, whether you are a company official representing or just a consultant. So once you have done that, that's it. Your registration process is completed. Then the next part is basically enrollment, which we have seen. You'll be taken to FPR's website, you'll authorize there, then you'll come back to the PRA website, you'll receive an activation info, the activation code on your cell number, the passcode on your email. Entering them, you would actually activate your e-enrollment, you would receive the password and PIN on both your email as well as your cell number, and you'll use them to proceed. Okay, so far so good. We're about to enter within the filing area. So, till now, if you guys have any questions, please feel free to ask. Now is the time. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. I'll give you a minute to write down the questions. No questions. Okay. So the questions started coming now. Great. Let me answer the questions. All these were answered. When actually sales tax on services became a provincial subject? This was asked by Mr. Feda Khan. Well, the sales tax on services, as we covered, became a federal subject post the 7th NFC award and 18th amendment in 2010. The KP Revenue Authority was established and relevant legislation completed by the KP government in 2013. SIN was the first one to follow suit after the 18th amendment and establish their own provincial revenue authority and legislation in 2011. Punjab was the second one doing the same in 2012. KP was the third one doing it in 2013. Tariq Khan, sir, will they allot STRN on e-registration or e-enrollment? Well, the number is allotted to you, Tariq, once e-registration is complete. You have the number, but you can't log in, you can't do anything until your e-enrollment process is complete. Okay, any other questions? There's no shame in asking the question. No question, it was a stupid question. Okay, what is an NFC award? Well, you might have heard that annually in the news near the budget. Basically, the NFC award establishes how the collective revenue of the country are to be distributed among the federating units and the federation. Okay, for what purpose they are used for? Well, Tariq, they are used for the purpose of distributing the national resources, the tax revenue, the borrowed money, other resources, particularly the taxation revenue between the federating units. Anything else? If not, we'll proceed. So I'm assuming that it's been pretty good so far and you don't have any questions, because that's all the questions I got. But keep them coming. If you do have any questions, we'll come back to them in a bit. Okay, guys, we will take a namaz break around, I guess, 4:10. Let's do that. Yeah, we'll have the namaz break at 4:10 for 15 minutes, 10-15 minutes. That should do. Okay, guys, let's continue. So what we have covered so far is, what is taxation? Direct versus indirect taxation. What is sales tax? The evolution and history of sales tax in Pakistan. What is KPRA? When it was formed, the relevant legislations governing the KPRA. The tax period card relevant for KPRA. Then we discussed about the new registration in case you have NTN. New registration in case you don't have NTN. How to check the status of your NTN registration application. We also shared the contact info of KPRA. Then we discussed how to do e-enrollment, both in the cases of the new e-enrollment and e-enrollment activation. This brings us to now the e-filing of sales tax returns. We will discuss the filing of a new return. We'll also cover the filing of a nil, or also, or the one that's also referred to as the null return. We will then also discuss about revising the sales tax return. So once you log in within your member area, which unfortunately we can't, unless one of you can share their login info, then you will be redirected to your account at KPRA. On top, you'll see the declaration tab. You'll click on the declaration tab and it will show you the filing options. You will then click on sales tax on services return. Once you do that, and the rest of the area will cover not only filing of the revised return, but the filing of a nil return too. So this is the home page as we have seen. We entered the login ID password, we logged into the area, and then we click on declaration. And we select on the filing option for sales tax return. Let me just increase the size of this one so you can see it a bit better. I think this is better. So we are going to cover this handout from the KPRA, in which they have covered extensively how do you file your sales tax return. I actually really wanted to show you the login details and how it actually works within the member area, but unfortunately none of our client permitted us, and apparently none of yours permitted you to. But what you can do is, after we are done for this, go back to the recording of the PRA session. I used the detail of one of the company on whose board I sit in. So I did have the leverage there. And the tax return is pretty much similar to what KPRA is using. So what we'll be talking about here, you can go through the recording and see the real deal if you have never seen the return before. If you have already seen the return, you're working on that, maybe some areas you are uncomfortable with, they would be pretty much covered within this. So let's go forward. And yeah, meanwhile, if any of you do get their hands on the login info, please share. I would just love to cover it with the real deal. Okay. So first things first, we will have to log in within the portal using the ID password, which I have shown you here. This is the portal, kpra.kp.gov.pk. You enter your login ID and password, and it should get you in. Once you are in, then you will be redirected to your account at KPRA. Here, you will click on the drop-down menu of declaration, which will show you the filing options. Amongst them, you will select the sales tax on services return, and a form will appear. And you will have to fill in the tabs applicable to you. The form will be divided within logical section. The first section is the registry section, which shows your registration particular, like your KNTN, NTN name, CNIC, depending on you are an individual or not. So this section is pre-filled. What you have to do is, from the left-hand side, you have to select the relevant tax period. For example, you want to do October 2017. So you will select October 2017, and then you'll click on the sales tax return if you have any tax payable. What we'll do next, I'll cover in a bit, but if you have no sales tax payable, you didn't do anything during the period, no business whatsoever, you will simply click on the nil return. Here it says click on nil return if nothing is due to pay. Not really. If you don't have anything to pay, but you have actually done businesses, business transaction, you should still file your return properly, enter the transaction details. You should file your null return if you did not have any taxable activity during the period. I think this is just slightly outdated, which they need to update. So if you did not have any taxable activity during the tax period, October 2017 for example, you will click on the null return. That's it. So what will happen once you click on the null return, it will ask you to verify. You verify by entering your info, your CNIC number, your name. It will ask you to confirm. You'll confirm it and it will be gone, submitted. Done. Just like that. Nothing complicated. Just pressing a few buttons for KP null return. It does take a bit more if you are to file a proper return. What do I mean by proper return? A return where there is actual taxable liability that you need to include. So, what do you do then? After you have selected October 2017, you will click on sales tax return. Then, you will have the return form KST03 appear, and you'll have to fill the relevant sections. The first section is logically the sales tax credit. Remember, they are both sides, credit and the debit. And the net is that you have to pay or is adjustable payable back to you. So in the sales tax credit section, input tax paid will be accumulated. You will have to enter the details of the transaction, the KNTN of the relevant party, the relevant service. You'll select from the drop-down menu, the rate that was applicable, the total amount. You'll do that for each and every transaction, or you'll simply enter all that data within an Excel sheet and attach that. Once you have done that, you'll have the link to actually, you are entering the domestic purchases info. This excludes the information regarding fixed assets for providing or rendering of services. The way the return works is, all the yellow tabs are automatically computed. You do not enter any data within that. You do enter data within the white tabs or the annexure. For example, in this area, you can't enter the total sales tax credit. Why? That's automatically computed. What do I do then? Click on the annexure. Once you click on the annexure, you'll be taken to a next, I should say, section, or the annexure itself, that's better to say. You'll be taken to the annexure A itself. Then you'll enter individually the detail of all the transactions, the domestic purchases that you have done, excluding any purchase of fixed assets that was done in order to provide your business services, taxable services, or even some goods. They are excluded. As I shared with you, the alternatives, you just enter all the details within the Excel sheet and attach that in the annexure. Once you have done that, you'll come back to the home page again. The next area that you have, 2.6.1.2, imports excluding fixed assets, including value addition tax on commercial imports. So see how it's working very logically. You are first talking about sales tax credit on your supply side. So you first have the domestic purchases, then logically you have imports. Both excludes the fixed asset. So within the imports, an auto-generated summary is given at end showing the status of supplier as a taxpayer. Again, you can't enter the information directly. It would be a yellow field, automatically calculated. So how do you get the data calculated? Click on annexure B if you have any imports. Remember one thing, most of your clients will not have imports. Majority of the SME are dealing domestically, they do not have imports. Yes, some of your larger clients, particularly the corporates, may have imports. So this section will not be relevant to every taxpayer. Don't get worried, oh, what should I do? I don't have any imports. Just move on. What's not applicable to you is not applicable to you. However, if your client or your employer do have imports, then you need to entertain this section. So if you do have any imports, you input the claim for input tax adjustment. Again, the same way like it was done in annexure A for domestic purchases. However, there will be a difference. The difference will be the details. You would need the GD, the good declaration form. You possibly will also need the landing form for the declarations, the values, the applicable taxes that are paid, and you will enter them within annexure B. Once you have entered them, the system will try to cross-check and verify whether that exists, and then you can save that and come back again to the home page of the return, which is your KST03. Okay, next one, capital fixed assets, including both the domestic purchases as well as the imports. Here you will separately enter your purchases of capital fixed assets and sales tax. Then non-creditable inputs, what can they be? Anyone? Well, no surprise, exempt items. You do remember zero rated can be adjusted, exempt is not adjustable. Hence the reason why businesses almost always prefer to categorize their relevant supply areas as zero rated instead of being declared exempt. That is because of this tax treatment. An exempt item is non-adjustable on the input side. On the other hand, effectively, you are paying zero rate. You are paying zero on the exempt item too. But the legal difference is that the exempt item can't be adjusted, so you are not effectively getting the benefit of this purchase expense vis-a-vis your sales tax. However, if the item was to be declared a zero-rated item, then you can claim the adjustment. Anyway, so exempt item, non-tax supplies, suppliers rendering of services or services provided in other jurisdiction and tax there are non-creditable input. So if you provide services in Punjab and they are taxed in Punjab, no surprise, it's not creditable for KP return purposes. I do know these things are some problem areas for businessmen, and even from the ACCA front, we have been raising this issue of the harmonization that, okay, there are four provincial authorities now and the FBR, but there should still be some harmonization for the businessmen not to suffer. If they are paying tax in one jurisdiction or the other, there should be the harmonization effect that they get. They do get the tax credit for that, especially if they are doing one-off transaction in other provinces and are based in a certain province. Okay, I am getting some questions. Please keep them coming. I will take a question break shortly and try to answer that. In fact, it's 4:07, 4:08 almost. So why not I answer the question and then maybe we can have a quick 15 minutes break. Everyone go quickly, get fresh and come back, and then we'll finish off the session. Okay, the question I received is from Muhammad Rahman Rashid. For e-registration, is it necessary to have an NTN number, or you can directly start paying tax online by going to KPRA website? Okay, Rahman, I think you probably joined late. We have covered this before in detail. I will still quickly recap what we covered. For e-registration, it is effectively, for all practical purposes, necessary to have an NTN. If you don't have an NTN, you can go to FBR website and quickly get one. You will need to get an NTN. Without an NTN, you just cannot simply register with KPRA and just only pay sales tax. Doesn't work that way. NTN is your basic identification. Whether you want to register for sales tax with a federal body, KPRA, or any other provincial body, you first need to have an NTN. That is a requisite, prerequisite to have your sales tax registration. I hope that should have answered this clearly. Any other questions? And by the way, you just can't pay sales tax by going on their website. You would still need to file your return. And for that, obviously, complete the e-registration, e-enrollment process. So, any questions? No questions? Okay, that's good. So, this means we are doing pretty good so far. You are understanding everything. Let's quickly have a 15 minutes break. And we'll continue from here at 4:25. And we'll finish this off in 1 hour 35 minutes thereof. Okay guys, I'll see you all in 10 minutes. Hello, assalamu alaikum, and welcome back to all of you. I hope you will all be fresh after that little break now. So we can just continue from where we left. Just very quickly, I have a quick question. So I'll answer that before proceeding. Tariq Saab has asked, sir, if my business is based in Punjab and I'm providing services in KPK, do I need to enter the details of import and capital expenditure in return? Tariq Saab, I'm assuming that you are asking about KPK. There are two aspects to this. One, whether you mean if you go into a different provincial domain, that's import. No, that's not. If you actually had imports and you are submitting your return with the KPK authority, then you should enter that if those imports are related to providing the services that you are delivering in KPK. If these imports are related to the services you are providing in Punjab, then they need to be entered in the sales tax return for Punjab. I hope that answers. Okay, guys, with that, let's continue from where we left off. Okay, so the last thing we covered before the break was capital and fixed assets, both domestic as well as imports. Next one, in fact, we also discussed this quite a bit. Non-creditable imports, they cover the exempt item, non-tax supplier or rendering of services and services provided in other jurisdictions and tax there. So after all that is done, input tax for the month is computed automatically for you. The formula for that is they basically just add up all the details that you have provided till now and take out the non-creditable inputs. So you have the net input tax figure for the month. So this is calculated from the input information that you have provided by entering the invoices in the system. Then the credit carried forward from previous tax periods determined by the department where applicable should be there. You can enter any credit as determined by the department with regard to sales tax held by the buyer as a withholding agent. You can also enter the amount of the sales tax deducted by the buyer of your services as a withholding agent. Then, after you have entered sales tax withheld by the buyer as withholding agent, you move on to accumulated credit. Now, this is the sum of 5, 6, and 7. So, you had all these figures filled up, and the return will automatically compute the figure for you. Next one, we'll go on the debit side. Till now, humne kya kiya hai? On the credit side, we have given all the details. Domestic purchases kya hui, hamari imports kya, imports hamari kya hui, exempt items, what were the exempt items. Then we have made all the adjustment. If there was any tax credit carried forward, that is also added. Okay. Muhammad is saying that he is having issue listening to us. Can you all hear me properly? Can you just comment so I know it's a one-off issue? Because the system isn't showing any problem. Everything appears to be fine. Yes, got back. Okay, great. Let's move on. So next up, yeah, we have done the credit side, so now we'll move on to the debit side. In the sales tax debit section, this will basically calculate the total output tax for the tax period. Details of each items will be provided. Again, you can't fill the entire return. You will fill in the annexures and the white fields. That's it. That's all you have to do. Thank you. So, first things first, service provided or rendered. Again, the yellow field, the total will automatically be computed by the system for you. You will click on an extra C here. What was an extra A? Domestic purchases. What was an extra B? Imports. What's an extra C? Your domestic sales. So in an extra C, you will enter domestic sales. Again, once you click on an extra C, you will be taken to this particular extra where you will feed each and every sale invoice detail, the KNTN number of the relevant party to which the sales was made, the amount of the sales, applicable rate, or what service was it for, whether it was service or something else, or a mixture of service and good, etc., etc. What is the amount that you withheld? What was the total amount? Or you can enter all these details in an Excel file and attach them. So either way, you can get it done. Okay, I have some questions coming. Keep them coming. I will be taking questions, answers in between, and I'll answer these as soon as we get to the next break. Let's finish this first. So after you have done this, logically the next step will be to go back to the home page of return and fill in the information of exports. So you can see the logical order there. You started with the domestic purchases, then you moved on to imports, you made an adjustment for non-creditable items, you have the net input tax available. Then you made an adjustment for any carried forward credit. Then the second side, the second section, debit section started. First thing, domestic sales. Logically, the next area is what it should be, the exports. Again, most of your clients will not have this applicable to them. Most of the SME sector particularly is dealing within domestic businesses only. Even most of the large corporations are focused on the domestic market. It will, however, be applicable to you if your client or if your employer, if you're working within a company in that setup, are actually involved in exports. So if you are dealing with the case of someone who is not involved in export, don't worry, common sense, move on. It's not applicable to you. So in this section, we'll enter particulars of any exports made during the tax period. Again, you won't be able to fill in the yellow parts. That will be automatically calculated by the system for you. So what can you do? You'll click on an extra D. So an extra A was domestic purchases, an extra B, imports, an extra C, domestic sales. Now an extra D, logically, the exports. So in an extra D, you'll again enter details of all the exports that been made. You would certainly need your custom documents for the value, the tax that's been paid, etc. Instead of entering each and every invoice detail manually in the system, you can also just upload the data from an Excel file, but please make sure that the data is in the same format as provided in Annexure D. So that's just a shortcut to save you time and avoid duplication of effort. Once that is done, you will have the output tax for the month. This will be auto-calculated on the main page of your return. This will lead to the determination of your tax liability and then input for the month admissible under the rules. The formula is provided. Again, it's very simple. The tax liability is computed as the difference of your debits, the output side, the input side, net off. If you have more output as compared to input, you have a tax liability. If your input is more than the output, your tax liability is negative, which means you have some actual adjustment accrued to you, which you can carry forward in your next tax period and claim a tax credit for that. So, available balance, debit or credit, will appear in serial number 13, and the output admissible during the period withheld by the buyer is auto-calculated. That's fine. It will then ask you whether you want to carry forward the inputs of capital or fixed assets declared at serial number 3 above. Remember when we started here in the beginning, we had this section of capital or fixed asset, both domestic purchases and imports. Here you have the option whether you want to carry it forward or get the adjustment within this period. So depending on, obviously, your taxation perspective, whether you have a big liability or you actually already have some credit that is accruing back to you, you would decide whether to carry this forward or claim it within this period. So the next formula will be automatically calculated. This is the sales tax payable. It's simply the same figure that you got here in 2.6.3.2 available balance, debit or credit, only adjusted for serial number 3, whether the input on the capital asset is claimed on this period, within this period or not. So this brings us to near the end of the return, whether you want the credit to be carried forward, then end of year refund claim, if any, you can put in the figures there. Depending on the figures that you have put in before, actually, this will be auto-calculated based on the data you have provided by the system. Net credits are carried forward. The formula is very simple. If the tax month is June, then it's zero. Otherwise, zero. So what this is saying is, if the tax year ends, then no carry forward. Otherwise, as periodical, you can carry forward, which effectively means that you can carry forward your adjustable credit within one tax year. Okay, then you have the column for any penalty, fine, or default surcharges or additional taxes. You have to enter the amount of penalty that may be applicable to you. Then the total amount paid to be paid is actually the sales tax payable plus any fine, penalty or additional tax or default surcharges, and this figure is auto-calculated. It's simply add the figure of fine, default surcharge to the last figure that was computed. The tax paid on normal or previous return, which is applicable in the case of an amended return. I did mention to you, we'll also be covering the aspect of revising a return. So if this was actually an amended return, you will actually just change the figure in the relevant areas, which I'll discuss in more details in just in a bit. But what's more important is you will also need to put in the figure of the payment that you have made. Why that's important? Because as we'll see just in a bit, you won't be able to submit your tax return unless you have paid off your tax liability. So when you are revising your sales tax return, you want to take credit of the payment that you have already made instead of again making the same payment. So you have to enter the amount of the tax payment that you have already made using the challan. Okay, so this brings us to balance tax payable. This will be auto-calculated. Then if they have just added this provision, no refunds are issued at the moment, but if they ever decided to do that, you can simply select the account in which you want to receive the refund if one is due to you, and that's it. Your return is pretty much done. You'll save the return form, and after clicking on the save button, it will ask you to verify. You'll click on the verify, enter your CNIC number, click on the verify button. You have now verified that this is the return prepared by you and you are satisfied with that. After verifying, before submission, you can click on unverify if you want to edit anything. You have saved the return, you have verified it. You just noticed maybe you missed a couple of invoices. You need to amend that, but you haven't yet submitted the return. So what can you do? Click on the unverify button again. Put in your CNIC number, your security details, verify it, unverify it actually. Once you have unverified it, the return will again open up for any amendments. And once you have made appropriate amendments, you will again click on the verify button, enter your CNIC number, verify that it's done, and that's it. It will effectively be locked for any changes. So after that, if you have a tax liability due, you will need to make an e-payment and enter the CPR number. You will not be able to submit your return without doing that. So there are two ways to do. You can either make the e-payment or you can still go to the manual payment. In case you want to make the e-payment, if there is some net tax payable against your return, the button e-payment will again be automatically updated at the end of the return. This would previously have been frozen, but now that you have a tax liability, it will become active live. So you'll click on this e-payment button, and follow the instruction to create an e-payment PSID, which is the abbreviation for payment slip ID. It is also referred to as a bank challan, payment challan. Take this payment receipt, sprint to a bank, appropriate bank, National Bank of Pakistan, the closest branch, and make the payment against it. A CPR number will be issued to you by the bank against this payment, and that CPR number will go into the database of KPRA. Until the payment is cleared by the bank, the button remains disabled except the print return button. Once the payment is cleared by the bank, the button enter CPR number will be enabled. Now you will enter the CPR number, it will fetch the details of this CPR from the system, from National Bank's database that is being connected with KPRA's database. It will have the details, okay, you made this payment on this date of this amount against this bank challan. There would be an automatic verification for the payment. Or if you don't want to go through that route, what you can do is make a manual payment. How do we go about doing that? Well, you pay the net tax payable amount in the bank against your sales tax return. A CPR number will be issued by the bank against the payment. After you have been issued a CPR number by the bank against this payment, you enter the CPR number issued and the amount paid against the CPR by clicking enter CPR number button. Now the submit return button will be enabled. So you will simply click on the submit button after you have typed the return, and it will ask you to confirm whether you want to submit this return or make any changes. Be very careful, because once you have submitted this return, it's gone. You can't amend the data anymore. So after you have submitted the return, done, it's gone. Now if you need to change anything within it, you want to amend some data, maybe miss some sales invoice, or maybe your clerical staff forgot handing you over a purchase invoice and you make an amendment after you have submitted. In such a case, you won't be able to amend the data anymore. What you will be able to do in such an instance would be instead to revise your return. How would you do that? The revise button is enabled only after you have submitted the return. So you'll just go on in your folder, you'll select the return for the relevant period, and at the bottom of the return, you will have that button enabled for you to revise the return. So by clicking on the revise button, you can revise your sales tax return. When you click the revise button, you have to follow the above mentioned steps to submit the revise. So what effectively happened once you have clicked on the revise return button is that the entire entire same return that you have previously submitted would again come in front of you, and now it will be unlocked. The same rules will be applicable. You can't fill in data on the main return within the yellow boxes. They will be auto-calculated. What you can do is fill in the columns which are white if they are applicable to you. One of them will be, which we just covered, the payment you made in the last return, with the last return. So that will be white on the main return, and you'll enter the payment figure there. Other than that, your four major annexure A, B, C, D, you will click on these annexures and amend any data. Maybe you need to delete an invoice, it wasn't correctly entered. Maybe you just want to amend it. Maybe an invoice was altogether omitted and you need to add the data within this return. So whatever the scenario, the process will be the same. You will go through the same process that we have covered, and you will amend the relevant section of the return, and then you'll save it. After saving it, again you will verify. And after verifying, there could be one of the three possibilities. Your tax liability did not change because maybe there was adjustment on both the sale and purchase side. In such an instance, you can simply move on to verifying and submitting your return. That's it. your tax liability is actually less than what it was before. In that case, you have to decide to carry the credit forward, enter the relevant figure, verify, submit. Or your tax liability is actually a bit more than it previously was. So what you need to do now is enter the payment figure that you have already made. And after that, the same process, verify, generate your challan like we have discussed right now here. The e-payment option, that's the most comfortable one. You just click on the e-payment button, create the PSID, take it to the bank. If that is not working, you can use the manual challan generators from FPR's website or even from KPRA's website and use them. But normally it's pretty simple. You just use the e-payment button. But in case, the point is, in case you have an additional tax liability, then you have to pay that additional liability, create another payment challan, and add the information just like before. Again, save the information, verify that, and then submit your return. So that's pretty much it with the revision. Being a professional, you should always keep records. So you need to print the return using the print return button in the sales tax return. After clicking the print return button, the return you have submitted will be opened as a PDF file. But common sense, all of you would know, you need an Acrobat, Adobe Acrobat reader to read the file. And you simply print it. You keep a copy of that for your records. Make sure pop-ups are allowed in your browser. Internet Explorer is the best one to submit the returns. If you don't have the pop-ups allowed, it just wouldn't work and you'll think there might be a technical issue, but you only need to allow the pop-ups here. In addition to that, you also should click on the acknowledgement button and a web-based acknowledgement slip is displayed, which you should also, using the similar mechanism, print. Remember, they are two different things. Acknowledgement is basically a confirmation that yes, you did submit your return using the online system, and the return itself is the complete returns printout for your own records, so that if you need to access it in future, you can do that. So that's pretty much about the whole process. I'll take any questions that you have, and again, if any of you have some login info of yourself or a client who are willing to share that for the display, and needless to say, please make sure you have their authorization before sharing that, so we can actually go within the portal and just quickly show you a real-time demo of this thing as well. Okay, we have a question from after Rasul. After clicking the revise button, you can make changes, or one has to get approval like an FPR explaining the reasons of revision. Well, within KPK, currently if you are doing it like immediately afterward, the system allows, but if you are doing it after some time, maybe a month, 2 months, 6 months, a year, for whatever reason, then you need to apply for permission or the system to allow you that. You just write to the commissioner or follow up by a visit and they normally give you the permission. Sir, if we have a company in KPK and we provide services in Punjab, then what should be the tax consequences? Should the sales tax be deposited with KPRA or PRA? Naveed Ahmed, very good question, Naveed. This is one of the major tax harmonization issues faced by the taxpayer, and something that is creating a lot of hassles. And obviously, different professional bodies are working on it. We, on behalf of the members at ACCA Taxation Committee, have given our proposals to the relevant revenue authorities and Federal Board of Revenue, as well as the Finance Ministry, to adjust these issues. What happens at the moment is, if you are registered in a certain jurisdiction, they ask you to get registered with them. Then they say if you are providing services in their jurisdiction, you have to pay them taxes. Now think about it. The problem is this. If I'm registered with PRA and I'm providing services in KPRA, there's a duplication. PRA would claim its jurisdiction and KPRA would claim its jurisdiction. So, in most of the cases, taxpayers normally work on such a basis. Such taxpayers normally have a number of transactions taking place in various provincial jurisdictions. So they file their returns in a way that the net balances off. However, if you are unfortunate enough to face a situation where both or even more provincial jurisdictions are claiming, provincial bodies are claiming their jurisdiction, then you simply have to contest one or the other. Normally, the principle that they follow is where you are providing the taxation services. That has been pretty strong in the past. So for example, say you are providing taxation services, taxable services in Punjab, then using the past precedents of what taxpayers have been contending and at time being given relief for, PRA would have the major right. PRA would have the first claim. But unfortunately, these things haven't been written so much in black and white, so you would probably need to contest them. I hope that makes it clear. Sana and Tiaz, I would like to add that MOU has been signed for the tax adjustment with FPR, but not with other authorities. Yes. Oh, yes, Sana, that was the next point I was coming on. There has been an MOU signed for tax adjustment with FPR, but unfortunately, the provincial bodies are yet to devise a mechanism for harmonizing the taxation issues within themselves. And that is just unfortunate because, as you would know, recently a report was released that Pakistan has came further, Pakistan actually came further down on the ease of doing business. And I'll share with you, when businessmen come to us and we actually try to encourage them to get registered with the taxation authorities, one of the prime issues they cite is the complexity and lack of harmonization. You might be surprised to know that an average businessman in Pakistan needs to spend at least almost thrice as much time on tax administrative affairs as his or her counterpart in Sri Lanka would need. So I'm not talking about the developed world, I'm talking about the part of the world we are living in. Just imagine, if that's the condition here, how difficult we are making things for the businessman and the taxpayer. So certainly that's an important area that needs to be adjusted. Good points, sir. Totally agreed. Anyone else? Any other questions? If we have a company in KPK and we provide services in Punjab, then what should be the consequences? Should the sales tax, this has been answered. Sana's answered, Akhtar Rasool answered, Tariq Saab answered. Okay, I'll give you a minute to write any questions that you may have. After that, I'll assume we have been doing it so well, you have no questions, and we'll just proceed further. Your time starts now. Seconds. Mati Vahmat, can we ask a question other than topic? You know what, Mati, try to focus on the topic or related to sales tax. However, if you have any other question, just write it down, ask it. After we have answered the relevant question and covered the topic, sure enough, if we have time, we'll just answer that. Okay, guys, last 10 seconds. Okay, Mateem has asked, can an ACCA affiliate and member become tax practitioner, and what are the procedures? Okay, let's see if we get a relevant question. If not, then I'll answer you, Mathieu. Anyone else? Okay, the time's up. So I'm assuming that there are no other questions. So I'll just answer Mateep. Okay, Mateep, you have asked whether an ACCA affiliate and member can become tax practitioner and what are the procedures. Well, the good news is, yes, of course they can. Not an affiliate really, but an ACCA member surely can. The way it works is, if you are just working as a consultant, you don't effectively need any other thing, but you do need to ensure that you have local taxation knowledge. I believe you do have the option of local tax variant in ACCA, so you should take that. If you, for some reason, you haven't taken that, you took the UK variant, then I suggest you need to top up your knowledge. For that, ACCA has done extensive sessions, and every year the update sessions are done on different taxation areas, income tax ordinance, sales tax act, KP sales tax on services act, SINs, Balochistan's, and Punjab. All the recordings are available online on Vimeo as well as YouTube channel of ACCA. The copies of them are also available on my personal channel by my name. It's the same thing, one and the same thing. Go through them. If you still believe you need more insights, then there are some different good publications. You can go through them. The idea is basically to top up your tax knowledge. Once you have done that, you have two routes. Number one, if you are confident in your taxation knowledge and abilities, you can go to your local tax bar and register with them as a member. They normally require, along with your ACCA qualification, certain experience working in a tax practice. That basically varies from bar to bar, but normally they require between 2 to 4 years experience working within the tax environment. Once you have done that, you would be authorized and allowed not only to provide consultation services, but also be able to represent your clients at tribunals and appellate authorities, as well as deal with FPR and all that. The other one, if you are not so confident in your local knowledge of taxation and want to test where you stand, then you can apply with FPR for something that is called ITP, Income Tax Practitioner. They will assign your application a number, put you in a queue. Hopefully in 3 to 6 months you'll get a time. They'll take a test, a quick interview, and based on the results, they would either allow or reject you an ITP license. Again, based on that license, now you can become a member of the tax bar and go through the same process. So you don't really need to go through the second option, being an ACCA member. The only other thing that you would probably need is the experience working in the taxation environment. So I hope that answers you, Mati. Mahnoor has asked, what is the scope for a person to practice in Pakistan with experience in a UK taxation firm? Well, Mahnoor, that's an interesting question because there are so many areas you can work in. Back office operations have started becoming quite common in Pakistan. So it might be that you are working on UK taxation, where the UK tax knowledge would certainly be very valuable. But if you are talking in the context of working with local clients on Pakistan tax laws, then certainly you need to have a very good knowledge and understanding and practice of the local taxation laws. The good thing is this, that our laws and so therefore our taxation system are basically Anglo-Saxon in nature. What this means is that they are basically based on the UK model. So if you have studied and worked with the UK taxation, your bases are there, your foundations are there. You can use them to actually polish your skills within the local taxation. But if you just have the UK taxation experience and knowledge, you would certainly need to top that up before you can go on to practice in the local laws. You can still practice internationally, like me, providing back office services to UK clients. But for a local one, you should really be getting to grips with the local laws. So I think that should have answered it pretty well for Mahnoor. Mateeb, thanks. Thanks, sir. You are most welcome, Mateeb. So any other questions, guys? Okay, I'll give you one more minute for this. And if I don't get a question in a minute, I'll assume you're all happy and we can move on. Okay, guys, almost half time's gone, 30 seconds up. Okay, we've got a question. Good. Keep them coming. If you have any question, feel free to ask. Now is the time. We are right on track, so don't worry. We have sufficient time. We have covered the bulk of it anyway. And yeah, meanwhile, if you have login info you'd like to share, please do that so the rest of you can have a look of what we were talking about, the insights as well. I'd be very happy to quickly show you that. If I'm paying sales tax under fixed regime, can FPR demand the sales tax under Section 3B of the Sales Tax Act 1990, the excess sales tax collected in sales tax, which is more than what has been paid? Sorry, sir, it is irrelevant here, but do answer if time is there after Rasul. No problem, after. Well, technically speaking, the fixed tax means that that's full and final discharge of liability. But there are certain areas, for example, if you have been dealing with a blacklisted one or the suspended supplier, then there are additional taxes to be paid. So in such a circumstance, FPR can obviously go for the additional tax. With regards to this 3B, the issue has been contested repeatedly. And last I checked, I think there was another recent case still within the judicial process. So normally the courts have been of the view that if it was just a final discharge of liability and there was no default or compliance shortcoming on the part of the taxpayer, then no. So however, if there was a compliance shortcoming on the part of the taxpayer, for example, if you were dealing with a suspended or blacklisting supplier, then FPR can go for the additional sales tax. Other than that, another way is if FPR do legislate, not really FPR, well, if the National Assembly do legislate and there is some additional sales tax that's been applied, then unless a court revokes that, that has to be paid. Well, the example of that would be the withholding taxes within, or the turnover taxes for that matter, within the income tax purview. Withholding taxes or actually the turnover taxes, sorry about that. The turnover taxes are basically indirect in nature. And your income taxes are direct tax. Still, what happens is, because the assembly has passed that legislation, it becomes the part of the framework under which the whole taxation regime has been governed and ran. So, to cut it short of that, to answer your question, not if the default is not on your part. I hope that answers your question. Next one. Okay, every time I give you a minute, in the last 15 seconds a question comes up. So one last time I'll give you another minute. If you have any other questions, please feel free to ask. Otherwise, I'll assume everything's been good and we'll just proceed. Okay, time starts now, guys. Wow, the session has been so outstanding that you guys have no question. Amazed. Well, I told you I'll answer all your questions. Okay, last 15 seconds. If you have any question, feel free to ask or we'll move on. And there we have another one in the last 15 seconds. Okay, you know what? If you have any questions, please type them. Let's just have them come within the database and I can ask them and I can answer them at the next question break as well instead of us waiting and then you having to type. Okay, Tariq has asked, if we need to fully understand the Pakistani tax laws, what resources we need to study? Okay, good one. Tariq, the first thing I would suggest you to do is go through the basic documents of the law. So for income tax, you should go through the Income Tax Ordinance 2001, the rules governing that, the withholding rules. Then for sales tax, go through the Sales Tax Act 1990, the sales tax rules. Then for the provincial bodies, go through their sales tax acts and their sales tax rules. Once you have done all of that, then or maybe along with them, you can go through the sessions conducted by ACCA. I have conducted detailed sessions on the Income Tax Ordinance, Sales Tax Act, Sindh and Punjab Sales Tax on Services Acts extensively in extensive detail, and the recordings are available on ACCA's channel on Vimeo and on YouTube on my own channel by my name, Omer, Zaheer, Meer. So you can go through them, they would be very helpful. Once you have done that, then you would have the basic knowledge. Then I would suggest work in a taxation environment. There is no replacement for the practical hands-on experience. Okay, next one is Muhammad Suleiman Sima. Is there any significant or minor differences between sales tax acts of Punjab and KP? There are no, it's actually an interesting question. I wouldn't say there are many significant differences, but yes, there are subtle differences. For once, the average tax rate of KP and Punjab are different. So some of the withholding rules are different. The larger framework are based on the same principle. So the basic framework and ethos are the same. However, some modalities are different, but there are no such major drastic differences per se. I would go to the extent to say it's at least 95% similar. Yeah, I think that answers you. Well, I don't know where that came from though. Okay, thank you, sir. You are most welcome, Suleiman. So I guess that's it. If you guys have any other questions, please simply type them down and I'll answer you again in the next question answer break. And that should take us back to our session. So we just went through the registration e-enrollment process. In registration, we discussed how do we register if we have an NTM. How do we check our registration application and what to do if we don't have an NTM? In the e-enrollment section, we discussed how do we go for a new e-enrollment and how do we activate an e-enrollment. And we are seeing the process completes with the enrollment process after the registration is done. We have also gone through the filing, revising of sales tax return on services for KPRA, and we have also discussed the simple process of filing a nil or null return. So that brings us to the next area, the current sales tax rates and implications. So broadly speaking, and do remember just a quick word of caution, these rates are revised annually in the finance sites. So broadly speaking, the KPRA taxes the telecommunication services on the same rates as the PRA, 19.5%, but the other services on average are taxed at lower rates, 15%. However, these rates are revised on an annual basis through the annual finance acts. Now, before I proceed on to the last segment of the day, I would quickly like to ask you guys something. Without cheating and without taking any help, can you quickly tell me the date, last date, the deadline for making the payment of your sales tax on services liability? There you go, start it. Okay, we have some answers. More. Come on, guys. Good. Well done to those who answered. And very well done to Sanai Diaz, the first one to answer. Keep them coming. Come on. Come on, guys. You can do that. More. 30 seconds. Let me see how many of you were actually paying attention. Can you please repeat the question? Surely. What is the last deadline of making payment of your due tax liability? This KPRA. Okay, guys, we got the answer. Very well done. Well, it's the standard date is what most of you have correctly pointed out. It is here, 15th of month following the tax period in general. With telecom, there are special rules, and the last date for e-filing of return is 18, the last date of payment is 15. Very logical. If you just recall what we just discussed for the return filing, before you can submit your tax return, you have to make the payment through PSID, commonly referred to as the bank challan of your tax liability. Hence the reason the deadline for paying your tax liability comes slightly before, 3 days to be precise, before the deadline for filing your sales tax return. Okay, good. You can keep your questions coming and I will answer them in a bit. Let's just try to finish it off with the last session of the day. Okay, here at the website, you can open the site in other browsers, no issues. Let me try to show you by opening this in Google Chrome, kpra.kp.gov.pk, and boom, it can be opened. No issue. Will it work? Normally it does. Internet is slightly slow at the moment. So let's give this a second.
Yeah.
Okay, so far so good. However, Internet Explorer is the best browser to access the website and file builder. At times, the other browsers may give you some problems. So ideally, always go with Internet Explorer if you have this available. Explore the website. It's always handy. You have these links which I've shown you, new registration and checking the status of your registration application, new enrollment and enrollment activation. You can also run the search utility to find the taxpayers by entering their KNTN. Okay, here we have the details provided by one of our members. And as you can see, KNTN, just like I told you, is basically your NTN preceded by the prefix K, nothing more. That's it. So you can see this belongs to University of Engineering and Technology. We have accessed the web portal close to 5:30 on 24th of November 2017. And you can see the service category has been educational support activities and the operational status is active. However, the profile is incomplete and KPRA are starting to work on it. So Shahzad and whoever shared this should ideally tell UAT to revise their profile. Normally they should have the date of registration, address, city appearing here, but you can see the operational status is active, so this is not a blacklisted taxpayer and you can actually deal with them without the fear of being charged additional tax liability. Okay, after the search utility, let's explore some other options. Let's get you familiarized. This is a good area because in the news section, in addition to the latest news, you also get to access the clarifications, notifications, and circulars. And if you want to keep yourself updated with what's happening in terms of event, you can go through the picture gallery. Okay, what is happening here is when the provincial assembly is not in session, and the revenue authority want to clarify something or make an adjustment, they are being vested the power to issue the circulars to make amendments within the regulatory framework. So you can select the period to see the latest news, and I want to see any news relating to 2017, 2016. None. Then any clarification related to 2017? None. Relating to 2016? Let's wait while this is being processed. So similarly, you can go through the notification, try to access them. If there are any notification, you can just make use of them. This is handy because do remember KPRA is a new body, comparatively new body, 2013-2017. It's just been 4 years really. It's in its fifth year now. So it's continuously evolving. They will start making more use of these. Similarly, circulars, you can see if there is any relevant circular. Yes, there have been 3 circulars within this tax year. The first one was issued on 9th of May relating to construction services, another related to the principal activity. This basically is for what I've told you, the incomplete profiles and the notification by the government that the taxpayer should start completing their profiles. So being someone in the taxation field, you should keep yourself up to date with these developments. Similarly, criteria for declaration of registered person as active or non-active taxpayer, This one is pretty recent. It was issued just in August this year. It tells you an active taxpayer is a registered person who is not someone whose registration is suspended by KPRA in terms of Section 45 of the KP Finance Act 2013, and who fails to file, who is not someone who fails to file the monthly sales tax return under Section 52 of the KP Finance Act 2013 by the due date for three consecutive tax periods. Three consecutive tax periods failure would lead you to be non-active. However, if you don't file your tax return by the due date, you can be penalized off even for a single month's delay. There are capacity issues at the moment. They are not penalizing everyone who is filing really late for just 1 month, but that is still effectively a breach of the law and regulation. So they are not doing that, doesn't mean they can't do that. The law is there. Should they just decide to enforce it from tomorrow, they can start doing that. So try to file your returns on time. Any person who does not fulfill any of the conditions prescribed above shall automatically become non-active taxpayer, and his name shall be removed from the active taxpayer list maintained by KPRA. A non-active taxpayer shall not be entitled to issue sales tax invoices. So anybody dealing with them will bear the additional liability. They have to withhold 100% sales tax and pass that on to government, because they would be the one that KPRA would go after if this guy does not submit their sales tax, and they can't. So you have to withhold the sales tax if you are dealing with such a party. They can't claim input tax or refund or avail any concession under the KP Finance Act 2013. No person, including government department, autonomous bodies, and public sector organization, shall not procure services from a non-active taxpayer. So ideally, you shouldn't even deal with them. How about restoring of as an active taxpayer? They can be restored if they file the return along with payment of any tax due with penalty and default surcharge under the KP Finance Act 2013. And the collector, on satisfying himself after conducting such an audit or other investigation and may be necessary, recommends the authority for restoration. So it's quite a complicated process. So ideally, you shouldn't try to even end up there on that list. Okay, inauguration ceremony of KPRA portal by Senior Finance Minister, 1st August 2013, and signing between Paral and KPRA. The idea is just to keep yourself updated with the developments happening on this website. The FAQs are pretty helpful. Do go through them. Then you have the help desk and support if you are interested in joining KPRA. By all means, carriers, tender notices. About us is basically blank. They are still working on it. And contact us. If you have a query, you can submit it here. But ideally, you should email them using this email and follow that up with a phone call. So what about the FAQs? Okay, they are pretty standard, so I'll just quickly show you while we move on. Okay, Khurram's problem is sorted. You are welcome. Omer saying, you are not able to view what I'm viewing. Can you guys see the KPRA website I'm showing you? Hello? Can you guys hear me? No. What? You guys can't see? Okay, that's troublesome. So why didn't you speak up before? Okay, there must be an issue. Let me crunch sales tax rates and implications. Okay, so basically you can only see the presentation slide. Okay. How about now? Can you see it now? Still not. Okay, let me call the technical help. I guess I'll just have to repeat it quickly. Well, thank you very much for highlighting this. Omer. Assalamu alaikum. Just need your help. ये इनको नजर नहीं आ रही, ये जो वेबसाइट है ना, ये इनको नजर आनी चाहिए, लेकिन इनको ये सिर्फ प्रेजेंटेशन का सफा नजर आ रहा है.
प्रेजेंटेशन नजर नहीं आ रही,
इन्हें वेबसाइट नजर नहीं आ रही, वो दिखा दो.
ठीक ठीक,
वो चल दिया. Can you guys see this now? अब आप लोगों को नजर आ रही है?
जी हाँ. Sorry बोल रहा
हूँ. Great, sorted. Thank you.
मैं पहले आया था. क्या हुआ क्या था?
Screen नहीं नजर.
Screen नहीं नजर आ रही थी, but it's sorted now. अब आ रही है. Great. So we can proceed now. Okay, guys. I'll quickly show you what I was doing before when you couldn't see the screen, but we'll have to be quick. The idea is this: you should keep yourself updated with the developments happening here. We have gone through some of the links, e-registration, new registration, having MTN, check status of registration application. We have seen that e-enrollment, new enrollment, and enrollment activation. We have gone through that. You can use this search taxpayer utility to actually search for any taxpayer whose info you have been provided with. Just enter their KNTN, click on the search, and here you have the info. Click on detail, just like you do on FPR's website, and you have this information here. So KNTN, as I told you, is basically your NTN preceded by a prefix K. That's it, nothing more. You can see the service category. Ideally, you should be able to see the address and date of registration with KPRA, and you can see the operational status at KPRA is active. So you can be satisfied that by dealing with this taxpayer, you would not end up having been on the wrong side of the law and bearing the additional penalty or sales tax. You can deal with them. So that's the good bit. Okay, please do give me a heads up if there's a technical glitch, so I don't end up sharing again, only to realize you couldn't see it. Okay, so this is done. Next up, news. You can go in the latest news and see what's happening. Being a tax practitioner, that should keep you posted with the latest developments happening. There are no latest news, so that's fine. Then move on to clarification. See if there are any new clarifications. There are none. Great. Move on. Notifications. Any new notifications? Just have a quick look. None. Great. Circulars. Yes, there should be three. These are the circulars. You can go through them. Principal activity basically lists that you should complete your profile, etc. There is one regarding construction activity, and this was the one which was important, and I read out to you in detail. This circular basically outlines the process of removing a person from being an active taxpayer. All it says is basically someone whose registration is suspended or who doesn't file their return for 3 years would be removed from the active taxpayer list. Such a person should not be done business with by any governmental organization and any public body, and even autonomous body. And how to restore the suspended or a non-active person otherwise who is in default must submit the outstanding returns. But now this time, along with the tax liability, the default surcharge and penalty surcharge. And after that, the collector can still conduct the audit as they wish, and if they are satisfied, they can be restored. So pretty strict set of criteria, and ideally you should try going into that sphere and avoid ending up there. So with that, the circulars are done. Then we have the picture gallery. You can quickly have a look here of the latest developments. Contract signing between Paral and KPRA on 10th June, and inauguration ceremony of KPRA portal by Senior Finance Minister KPRA on 1st of August 2013. Great. Next up, FAQs. There are four questions. What is the standard rate of tax? We have covered that. Is there any change in tax rate? No, but the Annual Finance Act can make the changes. What is the procedure of filing of return? We have covered that. How to obtain the STRN for KPRA? We have already covered that. Great. You can quickly go through that. Sales tax registration number may be obtained either through electronic request or manually. There is no fee or charge on obtaining this. Complete procedure along with relevant forms is available on the website and at the rules. In case you are already registered with FPI, you need not to obtain a separate additional registration. The system will automatically prefix the letter K with your previous registration and include you in the registration database. You will get information about such change, but in practice, you do have to e-enroll. So this is good. Next up is help desk and support. If you have any problem, you can click here and send them an email on support@kpra.gov.pk. And here, next one, carriers. If you are interested, there are some positions listed for you. Tender notices if you want to supply them something about us that's still under development, and contact us. You can give them a feedback or any issue you are facing, their addresses, all these details that have already been shared with you. Ideally, if you have an issue, send them an email, follow that up by call, and if needed, a personal visit. I wouldn't recommend just relying on this form though you can still try that. Nothing wrong with it. So these were some of the ancillary issues, and this brings us to, okay, you have seen on the website that there would be some dead links. For example, when we tried to click on e-registration having no NTN, that's gone, but they haven't removed it from here. So don't worry if there are some dead links. The site needs some updating. Browser issues I've already covered with you, that you do need to use the latest version of Internet Explorer. KPRA helpline has been shared. Evolving nature of KPRA has been shared. These two are gifts for you. This outlines the payment procedure, and then you have the challan forms. These are available in the handout section of the control panel of the presentation that you have. So you basically have four files there that I can see. First one is named OZAM KPRA challan form. This is the challan form that you can use to make payment manually, or you can just use the online PSID. Then you have the OZAM KPRA payment of taxes. It outlines the payment of taxes mechanism, which I have summarized and covered for you. Then you have the Omer ACCA KPRA how to e-file tax return. It's just the file that we have covered, and we have shared it for your reference. And then you have the Omer ACCA STR KPRA filing and registering, which is actually a copy of today's presentation. So that brings us to the end of today's session. We have covered pretty much everything that we set out to do. So if you have any questions, now is the time to ask. And yeah, here are my contact details. If you have any question about today's presentation, or even afterwards, do you have any technical question, feel free to ask me. I would be more than happy to help you assist my fraternity. The best way to reach me though is by sending me either an email, or even more quicker would be ideally to send me a message on WhatsApp or an SMS. The first time though that you contact me, please write your name and a brief intro where you work. And this was the first time that we interacted in this session, so I know who you are and I can save your particulars for future reference. I will try to respond to you as soon as possible, but at times I might be busy, just like I'm in this session, so all the messages coming here, I can't respond to them now. But I try to respond as soon as possible, normally within a day or two. So don't worry, just send me a message and I'll try to respond to you afterwards. The end of this session doesn't mean that you can't ask me anything more. You can still ask me and I'll always be happy to assist you. You would have a copy of this presentation for your records as it is in the handouts. So now, any questions that you may have? Muzammil asks, can you send us the file which you use for this session? Well, Muzammil, the files are already shared with you in the handouts. You can download them on your system and keep them for your records. They are already been shared in the handouts section. Can you find it? It's in the control panel under the polls. Well, I hope, yes, thanks. You are welcome. Okay, next up, let's answer the questions we have one by one. And meanwhile, if you have any other questions, feel free to ask. We have last 10, 15 minutes. Okay, Tariq Khan has asked, sir, I met a shoe retailer here which was charging sales tax to customers without issuing a sales tax invoice. Just verbally he was saying it's a tax. This happened when I was in matric. I meant, how can we get rid of situation like this in the future? What steps we need to take against him or them? Thank you. Well, that's a very good question, Tariq. I'm assuming by matric you mean that should have been quite a few years, maybe close to 2010, maybe a little bit before that or a little bit after that. Yeah, these things used to happen, still happen. The simple smart way is by the taxpayers asking for a receipt. It's your national duty. On the other hand, there are also enforcement initiatives that different revenue authorities are taking, and they need to be strengthened as well. And the penal action needs to be enforced against such characters. But most importantly, it's the masses. I mean, if every one of us asks them to issue us an invoice, what can they do? They have to issue an invoice, right? Then the regulators need to play their important role. They are the government service servants are actually paid to deliver a service, and they just need to ensure that they are able to deliver that service by keeping a check on such elements and ensuring they are enforcing the rule of law. Mateem Ahmed, the payments are on the manual challan or any online challan are available. Mateem, online challan is available using the PSID that I shared with you. Ahmed Khan, the slides seem to be stuck. Okay, we resolved that. That was done. Well, thanks for that head start, Ahmed. Current sales tax rates we have covered. Mohammed Suleiman, Sima, sir, can you recommend something to read on comparative analysis of provincial sales tax? Well, unfortunately, Suleiman, there haven't really been a good quality comprehensive read. So I'm afraid you'll have to read them separately to cover them. Though I do plan to create a comparative after I'm done with the tax deadlines. So just wait till January or do the hard work yourself. Muzammil, can you send files? That's been answered. Shahzad Hanan, how can sales tax be charged to customers in KPK by the service providers from Punjab under rules of KPRA? Well, in KP, you would not charge under the rules in Punjab. In KP, you would have to charge under the rules of KP. And if you are based in Punjab and providing services in KPRA, you need to, and I would suggest you to, register with KPRA so that you are not in default of the law of the land. Shahzad Hanan, or under which rules the service providers from Punjab region can charge sales tax to customer in KPK region? Just answered that. Okay, sir, thanks a lot. You're welcome. Great session. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Any other questions? If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Forum Shahzad, what is the monetary impact on central divisible pool after 18th Amendment and raising of provincial revenue authorities? And please comment on the practicality and efficiency of this change. Very good question, Khurram. Obviously, the revenue has actually increased because now the provincial authorities have a motivation to get them more. The more they have, they can keep it. And the remaining revenue that the federation is collected is still divided as per the MFC among the federating units. As to the practicality of the initiative, well, I believe it's a constitutional thing, and I'm not very comfortable commenting on that, but I'll give you a business perspective. The world is going towards harmonization. In the European Union, there's one economic area. Basically, one VAT system is governing the whole of the European economic area. You go across anywhere in the European economic area, you can adjust. The bodies have harmonized, they adjust the VAT in between themselves. In the states, effectively half the continent is one country. So similar thing. So regional cooperation organization adjusting for taxes. So the world is moving towards intercontinental or international collaborations in terms of taxation adjustment. Even Pakistan has double taxation treaties with certain countries. So in this era, having these provincial bodies where, there's the provincial autonomy thing and the revenue collection motivation, but the harmonization issues are a real thorn for the businesses. So I would suggest that the bodies, provincial bodies, should really work out amongst themselves to weed out these harmonization issues and ensure the processes as easy for businesses as possible, and it would serve them, because if the whole cake is larger, then the pie of the cake for everyone's share would be larger too. I hope that answers. Thank you very much. Great session. Thank you, Shahzad. Sana Imtiaz, thank you, sir. You are most welcome. Forum Shahzad, thank you. You are most welcome. Forum Karifan, thank you so much, sir. You are welcome. Then we have a question from Mansoor. Okay, I have visited a restaurant. They charge sales tax and issue sales tax invoice. But when I search their STRN number, which was written on invoice, I found that this number is not registered. So how to act on these issues? If the number is not registered, you can just send an email to the relevant body. I'm presuming from the use of SRTN, which normally should be STRN, sales tax registration number, that this is the central FPR with FPR. So you should probably shoot an email to FPR along with the copy of the receipt. You might end up getting a reward for the whistleblower. And then we have Mateeb asking, just like India launch one sales tax in every state. Yeah, but the harmonization issues should be sorted out. Yes, it is STRN. Sir, there has been some development regarding the intercity transportation of goods, sharing of tax among provinces. Yes, Sana, the good thing is the initiative has started. They are working on this with FPR. They have also signed MOUs. But the major thorn has been that the provinces haven't been able to settle among themselves the incidence of sales tax. For example, the common question that you guys were also raising, if someone is based in one province and providing the services in the other, they are registered in one and they are supposed to charge the sales tax in another. So when they end up filing the returns for both, it is often that both the bodies are claiming jurisdiction. So that causes a lot of problem for the taxpayer. Plus, there can be one return to submit where all the bodies will get their relevant data. I mean, you are entering the relevant tax number, KNTN, PNTN, SNTN, so they can search, they can just coordinate and ensure that they will be able to get the relevant data, just make life easier for the businesses, see them grow, allow them to facilitate them and allow them to work more freely and see how many businesses would come forward, and you would be getting more revenue as a result thereof. Mahnoor, how to send questions? Just like you have sent this one, Manu, type whatever you want to, press enter, send it. That's it. Muzammil Hussain, sir, is there any ACCA office in KSA who can arrange a webinar for us on VAT implementation? Well, Muzammil, that's a good question. Not really sure of that, but what you can do is send me an email for that. You have my email, and I will share it with the regional head of member affairs and others concerned so that they can arrange sessions on VAT. I do know for a fact that it's been discussed and in pipeline. So if more of you are interested on that and share your interest for it, it can be really brought to an earlier date, let me put it that way. Mahnoor, what is the scope for a person to practice in Pakistan with experience in a UK taxation firm? I asked previously. And Mahnoor, I answered you previously that you can work in Pakistan, but you'd be limited by your knowledge. So maybe you can work as a consultant to international businesses, maybe some UK firm on the UK business side, or in the back office operations providing UK clients from here the taxation services. But if you are to work in Pakistan on Pakistani taxation with the clientele, then you need to have an understanding. The good point though is the Pakistani system is largely based on the UK system. So if you have a good understanding of the UK taxation system, understanding the Pakistani system shouldn't be that much of a challenge, but no replacement for having the knowledge and hands-on practice. Brilliant session. Thank you. This is excellent session, sir. Thank you, sir. Mahnoor. Thank you, guys. You are most welcome. It's been a real pleasure. And I believe I've answered all the questions. So if you have any questions, yes, you have. Sir, can we opt P6 in Pakistani tax variant? Well, we have the regional head of member affairs joining us. So I'll leave this question for him.
Okay. It is not a very, Tariq, this is not a very simple question to answer. It's very complicated. There are many factors. I mean, the first answer, if when we propose this to our head of affairs, I mean, and MLP, by the way, has taken this discussion up already, you know, in the last MLP meeting where the chief executive of ACCA, Helen Brand, was present, this discussion was taken up. Now, the issue with that is that unless we have a sizable number of members doing the foundation level tax variant of the Pakistan tax variant, we cannot have an advanced level. The take up of fundamental level tax variant is very, very low, which gives an indication to the CHQ that the professional level variant will also not be very heavily subscribed. Now, it's a cash 22 situation. However, there's a big cost that introducing a variant carries. It's not just that ACCA one day announces we'll set up an exam in Pakistan variant also. There has to be a complete infrastructure in place, you know, before we can introduce it. However, in the absence of tax variants, I think the webinars that we have been delivering are providing excellent value. And we have observed, and Omer Sahib, please confirm that we have observed that the level of knowledge of our members on local taxation has considerably improved in the last 2 years at least. Sure. You know, from a time when it used to be very, very low and used to be a huge challenge, now at least, you know, there is a certain level of knowledge available in the market. Sure. And the other initiatives that the taxation subcommittee is taking in Pakistan, I'm sure it's going to go a long way in building a profile of ACCA members within the field of taxation also.
True. Thank you very much, Harun Saab. So you have your answer, Tariq. Well, I would second Harun on this, that when we started this journey almost 2 years back, we used to hear that ACCAs really lack the local taxation knowledge. And now we have reached a place where tax bars are recognizing us, our members can go get their membership, MOUs are signed, joint events are done, pre-post-budget events are done. Well, I've been honored to represent ACCA at tax bar as well as the chamber. We are doing a very unique initiative, in fact, a couple of initiatives I'll share with them. There is a taxation advisory group that is to be launched on LinkedIn. You will receive an email from Head of Member Affairs, I think within a week or two. That would be an important development. Similarly, we would be starting a taxation help desk at the chamber. So the businesses would start to recognize ACC members even more in terms of the taxation services. We are collaborating with the revenue authorities, the FBR, PRA, etc. So, as far as P6 is concerned, obviously it's a very important issue, but we members have a very important role to play. We need to enlighten other fellow members to subscribe more. If there are some issues, if the local tuition providers are not offering the courses, we need to bring that to the attention of ACCA Pakistan team. So those issues can be sorted out. Only if we have a good sizable base, we can make a very a strong case, as Harun has shared with you, there are certain costs involved and a case need to be made for that. Thanks for this session, and P6 is a very important issue, I agree. Yes, indeed, thank you for these webinars. You are most welcome. We are glad that the value has been delivered. So please, there should be some sessions on tax audits as well. That's a good idea. Sure.
Okay.
Sales tax audit procedures, okay. The issue that does, okay, this is noted. Thank you, sir. This is an excellent session. Okay, guys, thank you very much. I'm glad your questions were answered. I hope today's session has left you richer than when you came in terms of the taxation knowledge. The recordings will be available on ACCS channels. So keep subscribing, keep coming, and have a very good weekend. And see you all in the next session. Take care.